So let me present. As she said, I did a systematic review on recycled tires from rubber playground and athletic fields, and I looked at air pollution hazards to children. So just to give you a quick overview background of how we got to, you know, the product of crumb rubber. In the U.S., there's a huge tire disposal problem. The U.S. Rubber Manufacturers Association estimates that 246 million used tires are discarded each year. A lot of states have been placing bans and fines on tire dumping. Some states actually, there's a tire disposal fee that either you pay for or the manufacturer, like a mechanic, would have to pay. And it was actually mostly due to public health concern. A lot of the tire dumps hold water, and it's a big mosquito breeding ground. It's a big fire hazard. A lot of these tire dumps ignite into fires, and it's a problem to put them out. They take up space and that biodegradable also. So not only is it a U.S. problem, it's a global problem. 1.5 billion tires are produced every year, and there's an estimated 4 billion in stockpiles and landfills. This is the stockpile outside of Madrid in Spain. That's a recycling plant in Mexico for tires. I thought that was Photoshopped. It looked really weird, but there's other photos of it actually on fire with helicopters trying to put it out. U.S. is actually the number one in end-of-life tire waste. The U.S. just has a lot of cars. We're able to financially replace our tires pretty quickly. It's actually a big safety concern to replace your tires when the tread goes down. So now we get to the product of crumb rubber. Crumb rubber is made from used tires. When I'm talking about crumb rubber, I'm talking about the used tire one. So as you can see, they put them in playgrounds and athletic fields. That infill layer just below the turf fiber is where the crumb rubber would be placed. It's just loosely placed there. And it's an alternative. They use it because it's an alternative to natural grass. It's low maintenance and considered less expensive to, say, other synthetic fields. Originally, AstroTurf was made not with used tires, but with an actual polymer rubber that was specifically made for the field. So I couldn't find any data on how many crumb rubber playground fields there are in the U.S., but I found this in 2013. An estimated 975,000 tons of scrap tires went to ground crumb rubber. A lot of other industries use this ground crumb rubber. It mostly goes to rubber gaskets and automotive, but 17% went to straight to athletic fields, which I calculated was 165,000 tons. So why did I choose this topic? That handsome man on the left is me. I've been a respiratory therapist for 7 years now. In my profession, I work with a lot of population that are sensitive to air pollution, children who are asthmatics, cystic fibrosis, elderly who have COPD. They tell me stories where they had to sometimes even move because of the air pollution in their area. I've actually been directly exposed to this crumb rubber. I played in Florida on a league, and I moved up here and played on a league for a season. I played in Arlington, which was the first time I played on one of these fields, and I noticed this kind of black dust that was in my nose and on my skin. When I came home, and I take off my shoes and make a mess, and the wife would yell at me. And I looked at children, because that's a picture of my niece, she's 6 years old. I looked at children because they're developing and anatomically and physiologically, they might be more susceptible to kind of environmental risks of these contaminants. So when I went home after one day of getting this black dust on me as a public health student, I just did a quick search, and I found that there were some lab studies that found that there were some of these, they took samples from these playgrounds or fields and found to be polycystic aromatic hydrocarbons and volatile organic compounds and semi-volatile organic compounds. Also, some other heavy metals were found. And as we know, that many of these components are considered air pollutants and can have adverse health risk to your respiratory system and systemic health issues. So then I decided that I wanted to do this topic as my systematic review. The first part of the navigation guide is through the PICO statement. My participants were children worldwide. My exposure to the recycled crumb rubber playgrounds or fields. The comparator was actually any kind of field that wasn't made with recycled tire crumb rubber. So grass, mulch, and I said before, there's other synthetic fields Some actually fields use cork instead of the ground crumb rubber. And my outcome was looking at any kind of respiratory measurement. So stationary air monitors and personal air monitors that can measure these air pollutants. And I was actually looking for anything that would also use like biomarkers like blood or urine that would see if they were had any exposure. So I used the navigation guide like everyone else to rate the risk of bias and the quality and strength of the evidence of each study. So when I started my database search, I searched PubMed, Scopus, and ToxLine. Other sources, this category was used for anything I found in an unsystematic means, like suggested articles or in the references. I used the Prism flow diagram, and I limited my search to the last 20 years. So when I started my search, I typed in synthetic ground crumb rubber, synthetic fields, many different terms I used, and I came up with about 200. Removed the duplicates, and my exclusion criteria was it had to be children. Some studies only looked at adults. Some studies only looked at ingestion. I got down to about 10 studies that I can use. So this is just a little color coding of kind of the risk of bias. This is the grade I used for rate the quality and strength of the evidence. And this is a table I made for kind of give you an overview of each of the 10 studies I found. As you can see, there were some outside of the US, Norway, one from Italy. And most of them, as you can see, were mostly stationary air monitors. Only two studies used personal air monitors. This one study was kind of interesting. The New Jersey study here used artificial biofluids in their risk assessment models. In the Norway study up here, their comparator was a thermoplastic indoor field. And that is not a typo. This robotic air monitor was able to measure PM100, which I found interesting too. I just wanted to let you guys know that these four studies here, this New York study precedes this study. So one study got exposure monitoring air quality data, and then the other did a kind of risk analysis on that same data. And then the same thing with the Connecticut study. So here's my risk of bias. This is kind of the hardest part, just kind of deciding. We go back and forth, between what can it be. About 48% were considered a low risk out of all the categories. Selection process was probably high risk just because of the voluntary nature of the selection process. So I had to rate a lot of these probably high risk. As you can see, like kind of Norway didn't have that issue. I guess they just say we're gonna study and they don't have to say no, or EPL. So the quality and strength of the evidence. The risk of bias, I had to give a negative one due to the selection bias processing, some confounding issues and some of the studies. Imprecision, a lot of them, only two had personal air monitors. There was no biomarkers except for the one that used an artificial kind of a biomarker fluid. And then, so overall, I gave it a quality of low, and the overall strength evidence is limited evidence of toxicity. So I know there's a lot to read here, but I highlighted some important things I wanted to mention and significant findings. So this Norway study, the particulate matter are found to be within concentration one would expect in an indoor environment. The EPA one had three different regions of EPA that looked at certain fields in different areas. I just want to read that to you because I think it summarizes kind of all the findings. On average, concentrations of all components monitored in the study remain below levels of concern. However, given the very limited nature of the study, it is not possible to reach any comprehensive conclusions without consideration of additional data. And that's kind of the what I found out in all the kind of the risk analysis. They kind of the same thing that they said. Here's some other studies. This New Jersey one did find, they took like a smear sample and found some lead on some of the crumb rubber. EPA, there's no safe level of lead, but they weren't able to measure it in the exposure, but then they did a kind of risk analysis if the lead would get inhaled in any way, like modeling. So my conclusion is limited systematic evidence of toxicity. My original question, does exposure to tar crumb rubber increase risk of air pollution children worldwide, requires additional data and studies to evaluate larger sample of crumb rubber, playground the fields, and make some use of biomarkers. So there was many limitations. There's many types of kinds of rubbers. There's like summer tires and winter tires, which are different kind of rubber compounds. You know, the summers are tire and the winter tires are made different so they don't freeze. And limited site approval, as I mentioned earlier, during the selection process, there were some issues. There's some confounding issues. Some studies, they told the children who were in personal air monitors not to wear sunscreen, and they wore sunscreen, and there was some pesticides being sprayed in some other fields. There was a lot of confounding issues. This Norway study mentioned that they were able to find some around 70 volatiles in the air above in these indoor halls, but they don't know, there's not much information about a lot of them, and they were found at very low levels. So an ideal study, used biomarkers for the children, blood samples, urine samples. I didn't really find that in any of the studies. As a respiratory therapist, forced vital capacity, forced expiratory volume in 1 second. These are used just to find out people or children having like bronchospasms. They use them pre and post for when they give a treatment to see how effective the treatments are. We can use medical records, and I would like to see indoor fields and playgrounds with more controlled environments. So my acknowledgments, I'd like to thank Dr. Annenberg. Dr. Price was not here. Dr. Bukuma, my advisor, helped me throughout this whole time I've been here, and my whole cohort and all the professors. Thank you.
Well, there's so many different types of tires, et cetera, et cetera. Are they selective in the types of tires that they use to make that crumb rubber?
None of the studies defined really what, you mean the people that are shredding the tires and making
them?
I'm not sure. When I looked a little bit into some recycling plants, it looks like they take most tires, you know. There's a cleaning process, they shred them, and there's a magnet, there's a metal coil around the tires that picks up the metals. I would assume there's no real recycling process. Because tires kind of last forever, and they're made to last.
Yeah, great talk.
Thank you.
So, you know, I'd love to see one of these studies end with no more studies necessary.
Right? I'd like to say that.
We know everything there is to know about this subject, and we're done. So, I'm curious as to, I struggle with this one myself, because in fact, Dr. and I wound up being on a little mini study here for GW on rubber crumb, and kind of found the same kind of conclusions you did too. Not really good, strong evidence there. And I guess I struggle with, you mentioned something along the way, and I realize this is probably outside the scope of what you did, but artificial versus natural. With natural, you're probably also using herbicides and mm-hmm. you know, maybe some pesticides,
right.
Some weed and feed or something like that. So there's sort of, pick your poison, which type of field is optimal
right.
to, and you ended with, I'd like to see more controlled fields. And I guess I wondered what you meant by that, because what's the best kind of field to play on, I guess, would be the ultimate question.
Well, I was saying that maybe just to try to isolate if there's something specifically in this crumb rubber that we need to worry about that we're breathing in. But yeah, like you said, I mean, even I've played on fields that are real dry and a lot of dust comes up, there's not much grass, there's a lot of dirt spots. So, and you have
then
to
you get into ankle twists and
yeah.
you get in all kinds of injuries too.
Right. Yeah, actually I had to cut out a lot of studies. Some studies only looked at injuries from these athletic fields.
Because with and without crumb rubber, there's an increase in injuries without crumb rubber, is what I seem to recall.
There's an increase?
When you don't have the crumb rubber, you don't get the bounce in
mm-hmm.
the field as much? And you get more twisted ankles, and you get more knees blown out. And
yeah,
like
I found newer studies. I just randomly looked at them, but also were saying that they may cause more injuries.
With the crumb rubber.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
They were saying because some athletes weren't used to playing on them, and they
the cleats
they
and the
push back, and they might grab and
mm-hmm.
twist. twist ankles. But they just noticed that a lot of athletes began to get used to the playing on the field after point. Also, there was a lot of the ones that looked at temperature. It was a big issue. Those fields get very hot, which actually,
With the crumb rubber, they
get hot. They get really hot. Mm-hmm. Like there was huge differences in the middle of the field on temperature. All right, thank you guys.